listening to the audio production of I'll Be There, But I'll Be Wearing Sweatpants, Finding Unfiltered, Real-Life Friendships in This Crazy, Chaotic World by Amy Weatherly and Jess Johnston, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the authors. Dedication. To C, B, and M, who have changed me and inspired me since the day you were born, this book is for you three. Love Jesus, know yourself, do life with people, and remember that wherever the road takes you, whichever path you choose, I'm here for it. I'm here for you, and I'm cheering you on wildly from the sidelines. I love you through the moon. But please learn to throw away your trash, okay? I'm really tired of picking it up. To Brandon, who has kept me laughing from day one, thank you for basically locking me out of the house and forcing me to go write, even when I wanted to sit on the couch and pretend like deadlines didn't exist. None of this would have happened if you hadn't lovingly nagged me. You are my home and my favorite person on this planet. To my mom and dad, your support has meant everything. To the friends who have showed up, stayed with me, and taken me exactly as I am, I could never thank you enough. You make life so full and so fun, and I am so, so grateful. You know who you are. Love, Amy.
To Graham, who championed me and believed in me before I believed in myself. To my mom, who inspired me to be a writer, and my dad, who thinks I'm amazing even when I'm not. To my friends, new and old, who have been the inspiration behind every word of this book. To Malachi, Scout, Oakley, and Haven, I pray you build amazing friendships throughout your lives. And sorry about all the screen time and frozen pizza while I wrote this book. To every girl and woman who has ever felt alone, may this book be the beginning of a beautiful journey to friendship.
Introduction. We didn't write this book alone. We could have. Not to brag, but both of us are fully capable of penning these lessons and scripting these stories all on our own. But we didn't want to. In our guts, we knew it wasn't supposed to be a solo effort. It was supposed to be done together. We knew there was something beautiful and significant and poignant about birthing this book on friendship through the work of our own friendship. We love how this friendship has grown us and how it has carried us through some tough times. We love how this friendship has endured, and we love how it came to be. It wasn't by accident. We connected through blogging groups, and it didn't take us long to realize we were cut from the same cloth. We quickly bonded over our love of the Enneagram, Mexican food, going commando in leggings, and sharing way too much information with people we hardly know. Our first conversations were hours long. We talked about everything from pop culture to whether Topo Chico or LaCroix was better. We found it natural to chat and to laugh, and we found it equally easy to dig into the nitty-gritty of our lives and our hearts. We built safety and trust as we shared our real-life struggles and our real-life desires, particularly on the topic of sisterhood. As the days and months passed and our friendship grew, we talked about how independent the world had become and how much we longed to make a difference. We talked about our heartbreaks, our years spent in loneliness, and all the times we wondered what the heck was so wrong with us that we didn't have any friends. We talked about our stories of redemption and how we had both come to build some amazing friendships. We dreamed of conferences and speaking on stages. We dreamed of books and communities and giving women a space to come alive, a space to feel accepted, and a space to feel secure. And we dreamed of strong relationships. The kind of relationships we knew these women craved deep down. And before we knew it, our own tiny corner of the internet, Sister, I Am With You, came to be. We poured into that place. We prayed over that place. We wrote our hearts out. We watched this tiny spark become a fire, and we watched that fire grow and burn and light up women from all over the world, from all different ages and walks of life. Every word of this audiobook was born from our hearts, our stories of struggle and loneliness, as well as precious friendships. But this audiobook was also born from our friendship. It was born through late-night texts of, I don't think I can do this. It was born through 100 phone calls of laughing, venting, and encouraging. It was born through, It's going to be okay, I promise. And we can do this, I'm sure. It was born through, have I told you lately how much I love you and how amazing you are? It was born through random selfies of our double chins just to make each other laugh. It was born through flower scent just because. It was born through a surprise package of Ted Lasso stickers, and it was born in the year 2020 when absolutely everything was in upheaval and we needed sisterhood more than ever. The message of this audiobook is simple. Let's not do life alone. Let's do it together. And that's exactly how this book was written. Together. We can honestly tell you that although we could have written it separately, this book is a million times more beautiful because we created it with each other. We don't know what your story has been. We don't know what brought you here today. We don't know what heartbreaks you've suffered, and we don't know what beautiful friendships you've had and have. All we know is we're so glad you're here. This is our prayer for you. Dear Jesus, we pray for the one who is lonely. We've been there and we felt it. We know how excruciating it can be. We pray for the one who wonders if she's too much, not enough, and for all the women who teeter-totter back and forth between these two extremes. Show her that there's nothing wrong with her. She just hasn't met the right people yet. Show her that she is held, that she's victorious, and that she's your most marvelous creation. Encourage her heart and fill her mind with all the beautiful thoughts you have for her. Let her know we need her here because what she brings is priceless and unique. We pray for the one who feels defeated, for the one who doesn't know how to begin, and for the one who is exhausted. Would you bring her peace? Would you bring her comfort? Would you bring her friends? Highlight the one she should pursue and let there be opportunities to meet new people in the most unexpected ways. Give her the bravery it takes to be authentic and vulnerable and real, and give her the courage to try. We pray for the one who has a broken heart and wounded wings and is afraid to fly again. Patch her up, wrap her in care, and set her free. And most of all, help her feel completely loved, from the top of her messy bun to the bottom of her feet, even her toenails that badly need a pedicure. Shower her with grace and an abundance of rest. Fill her heart with hope and her mind with peace, and let her wake up with energy, excitement, and the very fullest of hearts. Let this audiobook meet her where she is. Use these stories to help her feel seen and these words to help her feel valued. Let the things she finds here stick with her and let them change her. And please, let this audiobook help her smile too. Amen. Love, Amy and Jess.
Chapter 1. When you really need a friend. Yeah, us too. Love, Jess and Amy. Oh, hey, we're Jess and Amy. We want to talk about friendship, but we're not just talking about the kind of friendship that puts on lipstick and pants with zippers and orders something fancy at a nice restaurant, although that's fun sometimes. We're talking about the kind of friendship that gets raw and gritty, the kind of friendship that is built for real life and running errands, the kind of friendship that is safe for big feelings, deep secrets, and laughing so hard you snort. The kind of friendship that stays through sickness, health, anxiety, and announcements like, hey, something is hanging out of your nose. We're not talking about the kind of friendship that means being with the in crowd or being on the VIP list for a party. We're talking about being on the VIP list for the hospital when your friend is having surgery. We're talking about being on the VIP list for kid birthday parties and movie nights in your sweatpants. We're talking about being the VIP in someone's real, authentic, and true life. We're talking about the kind of friendship that holds up under pressure, the kind that withstands a whole lot of heat. We're talking about the kind of friendship that has an open-door policy when laundry is covering the couch, the sink is full of dishes, and your hair hasn't been washed in a week. Thank goodness for dry shampoo. We're talking about belonging to each other, like really, really belonging. We're talking about a friendship that isn't just good for the freeway, but can pop into four-wheel drive and go off-roading too. A friendship that doesn't have to strive or perform, but is comfortable to curl up next to and share your whole truth with, no filters needed. We're talking about the kind of friendship that makes you actually want to pick up the phone. We don't know about you, but that's the kind of friendship we've wanted our entire lives and with our whole hearts. We wanted it, we dreamed of it, and yet it felt so far away, so unattainable, especially now as adults. We felt like we had shown up to the ball in our nastiest pair of sweatpants. You know, the ones with the hole in the crotchal region. They're not the prettiest, but they're real, worn in, and oh so comfortable. Plus, if it's hot, no biggie because you've got that sweet breeze coming in. If you've ever walked into a party and instantly felt like the outsider, if you've ever wanted to disappear, sneak away, moonwalk out of the room, or casually park yourself next to the host's pet with a plate of cheese and crackers for the rest of the night, we get it. Us too. If you've ever become best friends with your barista or your Instacart delivery person because you literally didn't have any other adults to talk to, yep, I am raising my hand here. Sister, I am with you. Their names were Anna and Leslie, and they were fantastic listeners. To all the people who are waiting for me to move out of the drive-through line, excuse me. Anna needed to know that I was having a really hard time lately. Anna got it. Anna cared. Anna also made a mean caramel latte. We were having a moment and your honking wasn't going to stop us. If you've ever walked away from meeting someone new and collapsed onto the steering wheel the second you got back into your car because you're pretty sure you'd ruin things with your big fat mouth, yep, Amy's turn to raise her hand.
I did this just last week and I was annoyed at myself the whole way home. Why did you say that weird thing about finding half-eaten Cheetos in your bra? This is not normal chit-chat. This is borderline disgusting. She is never going to want to hang out with you again.
If you've ever felt like you weren't enough, like you are too introverted, too boring, too awkward, too average to make any kind of lasting impression, yes, been there. And then we spent the next day thinking of all the witty things we should have said. We're very good at conversation after 3 to 5 hours of careful planning. Also, P.S., 90s movies really led us to believe we were going to have a Rachel Lee Cook moment and She's All That, only no one ever showed up to take off our glasses and transform us into someone cool. Never mind the fact that we don't wear glasses. We could have bought fakes, you know? If you've ever felt so bulldozed and blindsided by a friend breakup that you struggled to put your heart out there again, ouch. We've been in that same position a time or two. Losing a friend is deeply painful, gut-wrenching even, and it causes you to question yourself, stop trusting others, and put up walls so high and so thick they are almost impossible for anyone to climb over. We hope it gives you courage to know you're in good company with your feelings. When we think of certain friendships that we lost, our hearts ache like the breakup was just yesterday. If you've ever felt like you are too much, too extroverted, too prone to overshare, and too likely to overwhelm everyone like a golden retriever that didn't get her fetch time today, us too. Does everyone talk with a girl they literally just met at the park about how many stitches they got giving birth to their firstborn? Yes? No? Okay. Us either. Is it odd for said hypothetical girl to know this information before she even knows your name? If you've ever put your foot so far down your mouth that you thought your best plan of action would be to move to a new town or, better yet, a new country, yes, yes, and yes. New Zealand sounds nice. Let's pull up Zillow and see what kind of houses are available. Whew, kind of pricey. Scratch that. Canada, anyone? If you've ever felt so busy, so overworked, so chaotic that you couldn't imagine how you could possibly make time for friendships, yes. Speaking of which, can someone come over and take our kids to the dentist? They have appointments scheduled, but honestly, we don't know exactly when. Whoops. If you've ever had someone introduce herself to you, even though you've met her 10 times before, we are your people. Hi, I'm so-and-so. I don't think we've ever met. We have actually met multiple times, and we go through this exact cat and mouse dance every single time. It is so nice to have made such an impression on you. Doesn't hurt at all. We know the sting of being forgettable, invisible, and completely unseen. Sometimes adult friendship feels exactly like being picked last for dodgeball, and it makes us want to go home and cry too. Your tears are not lost here. If you have absolutely no idea how to even begin, if you have no idea where to look, and if you can't seem to make the plunge and dive into friendship with your feelings, yep, we get it. It is scary. You desperately want to invite people in, but what if they turn up their noses and run for the hills the second they see the real you? We've been there, and it's terrifying. Your heart is your most sacred possession. We want to guard ours too. If you've ever been scrolling through social media only to have your eyes go wide and your stomach jump straight into your throat when you see a picture of everyone together on an outing you weren't invited to, again, yep, we know the feeling. We feel sick just thinking about it. If you've ever wanted to scream, but how, when someone tells you to find your people, or if you've ever panicked while filling out a form and realized you don't have an emergency contact, then girl, you're speaking our language. Been there. If you've ever felt so insecure and so unsure about putting yourself out there that staying home with a bag of barbecue-flavored Lay's and pajama pants seemed infinitely safer than risking being rejected, same. This book is a personal invitation into our journeys, our joys, and our discoveries in friendship. It's our confessional. It's our tell-all. It's our let's do this together. It's our love letter to our daughters, and it's our love letter to our younger selves. We needed this book back then, even more than we needed to lay off the white eyeliner, CK1 perfume, and plucking our eyebrows into smithereens. But the truth is, we still need it. Nobody gave us a handbook on how to deal with friendships when we became adults, so we decided to write our own. More than anything else, though, this book is our love letter to you. We met 3 years ago.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.